Welcome to this final session of QPL, and in a change to the program, we've just swapped around the first two talks. So first off, it's Kevin Dunn who's going to tell us all about spectral precious token speco contextuality and quantile valued relations. Kevin.
Thanks. So I actually have two papers at QPL this year, but only one talk. So this talk is really going to be a little bit of both, but mainly this paper. But really, both are about the same project, which really is just kind of doing a bit of tidying up. Because recently there's been a lot of projects which seek to formulate some aspect of quantum theory, but using the language of, well, some flavor of category theory. But they focus on different aspects of quantum theory, and they use different kinds of category theory. And I've just been really trying to think how do the pieces match up? I mean, they all talk about quantum theory, so there should be some reasonable way in which they kind of talk to each other. So the approach that most people here are probably most familiar with is the monoidal approach, or the approach using string diagrams. And then, which I think we might see in the next talk, this kind of sheaf theoretic approach to non-contextuality. And then there's this the topos approach to quantum theory of Doring and Eystrom, which I've been assured by lots of people I'm the only person who actually cares about this. And then there's kind of more obscure things as well, kind of topos foundations of physics in general. And so I kind of claim to come up with something which kind of sits in between these things and gives you a way to move between them and hopefully apply the techniques of one to the other. So, for this, I've basically got three papers now which talk about this framework. The first one last year in quantum interaction, and then I'm going to be talking mostly about this second one here, but I'm going to sneak in some results from the last one too. So basically in this picture, things with the solid arrows, these are things that you can actually read about now, and the things with the dashed arrows are things that you'll be able to read about in my thesis, which I can assure Ross will be finished really soon. So we're talking about quantum mechanics, but before that I wanted to say something about classical physics. So classical physics really is just the study of commutative algebras. And I'm qualified in saying this because I read the first two pages of this book, and it gives you this picture here. So when you're doing physics, really your lab is just some kind of commutative algebra. Your measuring devices are the elements of the algebra, and your states are these algebra homomorphisms into your ground field. And we choose R, but you know, we can really choose anything here. But the real numbers make sense because the kinds of things you typically want to measure in physics, like length or duration of time, we can represent with real numbers. And when you do this, you get this really quite beautiful picture where the collection of states actually form real manifolds. So you get this idea of, you think of the state spaces are actually manifolds, and you know, everything just kind of works out really nicely. So that's classical physics. So what is quantum physics? Well, it's got something to do with non-commutative algebras. So in particular, you know, we can do all these experiments, and they tell us that a physical system really is represented faithfully by C-star algebra, which is the bounded linear operators on a Hilbert space. But we don't really know what to do with this. We don't really know how to interpret it. We lose the nice geometric picture that we have from classical physics. So how do we get around this? Well, Bohr's interpretation of quantum theory is something like we accept that the world is really, by its nature, quantum. But we're classical beings, and so we can only really interact with it in a classical way. And so the best we can hope for is understanding some quantum system just in terms of the classical parts of that system. And the way we can kind of formalize this is, okay, I know my quantum system is represented by the bounded linear operators on H, but really I'll just consider the commutative subalgebras. Because these are the things that I can actually get my hands on and interact with. And these things are ordered, so I just consider the collection of all of them. And this is really the object that I think of studying when I'm studying the system. And then maybe I restrict further, I consider not just the sub C star algebras, but the von Neumann subalgebras, because these are nicer objects somehow. So then the topos that you consider when you do topos quantum theory is just the topos of presheaves on this post set. So one particularly interesting one that's been spoken about a lot is the Gelfand spectrum. So it takes commutative subalgebra to the collection of homomorphisms into the ground field. And so remember, in our interpretation, this takes the subalgebra, which we think of some sort of classical context, to really the states that I can observe in that context. And so one of their kind of early results, which I think is really nice, is that the Kochan-Shebeck theorem is equivalent to the statement that this presheaf has no global sections. So here, this is the terminal presheaf, so the thing that sends every object just to the singleton. And you can kind of, this isn't so mysterious if you think what the spectral presheaf functor really does is it sends your classical system to its collection of states. And so what a natural transformation of this kind would have to pick out a state from every classical context, and naturality would tell you that it has to do this in some kind of consistent way. So it's quite, you can kind of believe that this is true. So that's the topos approach, and really it relies on all the same Hilbert space formalism of quantum theory, and we're really just sort of packaging things up differently, using new language on top of it. But when we go to the monoidal approach to quantum theory, we really want to abstract away from Hilbert spaces altogether, and we just want to say, okay, how much can we do if we just have dagger symmetric monoidal categories and with dagger byproducts? And it turns out you can do quite a lot of stuff with this. In particular, you encode some aspect of quantum theory as algebras internal to the monoidal category. So algebras are just things of this shape. So typically we all hear about Frobenius algebras. So Frobenius algebras are how you encode a notion of observables with the internal language to this category. And then a generalization of Frobenius algebras, a kind of infinite dimensional generalization, are something called H-star algebras, which are quite similar, but we assume that they don't have a unit necessarily. So this kind of lets you talk about infinite dimensional things. So we think of these as, this is how we encode the notion of observables in the monoidal approach. And it's the set-like elements of your algebra that really correspond with the observable outcomes or the states that you can observe. And when I talk about set-like elements for H-star algebras, we ask for this other condition as well. I'm assuming that they're normalized. Okay, so let's think a bit more about these monoidal categories. And we actually get quite a lot of stuff for free from this. Seems like not very much structure. So if we consider the endomorphisms on the monoidal unit, we get some algebraic operations. So we can define an addition operation, which is commutative, by the byproduct convolution. We can define multiplication just by composing these morphisms, and that turns out to be commutative. And then we also get an involution given by the dagger. So all that together tells us that these scalars form a commutative, involutive semi-ring. If we consider an arbitrary Hom set, we still get the same addition operation with the byproduct convolution, and we also get a kind of scalar action by these underlying scalars. And this gives us the structure of a semi-module where the scalars are the endomorphisms on the monoidal unit. And then if we consider sets of endomorphisms, we have all that semi-module structure, but then we also get another notion of multiplication by composing these maps. And so that gives us an involutive S semi-algebra, or suggestively call it an S star semi-algebra. And if you plug in the category of Hilbert spaces here, this really is the C star algebra structure that you get on the bounded linear operators. So even in these just general categories that the considered in the monoidal approach, we get this really rich algebraic structure on the Holm sets, and enough really to just kind of reproduce all the definitions from the topos approach. So for an object in my symmetric node category, I'll just take this ALG X to be the collection of all the commutative sub semi algebras. And I'll consider this the category. But before we were thinking about the von Neumann algebras, for the von Neumann C star algebras, but we can do the same thing even in this more general setting. So for a subset of this algebra, the commutant is just the set of all the things which commute with everything in that set. And I can just define the von Neumann semi algebras to be the semi algebras which satisfy the double commutant identity. And again, when you put in Hilbert spaces, this reduces to exactly what we were looking at before. Meanwhile, I stop here. We can define more things. So we consider the pre-sheaves on this poset, and in particular, we can basically just lift the definition of the Galfan spectrum. So I just consider the set of semi-algebra homomorphisms into these ground scalars. And I think of this then as kind of some kind of generalized state space. So I can make all these definitions, but there's really, you know, I haven't really given a good reason for why I would make these generalizations. So we want to kind of check that, you know, is this a sane thing to do? And the way I kind of justify this is that the notion of observable that you axiomatize internally to the category lifts very naturally to this external picture. So if you start with a Higgs-star algebra on the object X inside the category, and then you consider this collection of endomorphisms. So you might ask, is this collection of endomorphisms one of these von Neumann, commutative von Neumann semi-algebras? The answer is no, but you just need to close it slightly. You just take the commutant, and you actually get not just the von Neumann algebra, but actually one of the maximal ones. So the Higgs-star algebras defined internally somehow correspond with the maximal von Neumann algebras as an external picture. And so this is a kind of an internal versus external algebra point of view. And what I'm describing is all happening externally to that. But there are other reasons why you might do this. Even if you like to be in the internal world, this is the thing that you actually care about, moving to this external picture, you can learn something about your internal algebras. So the other paper is how when you move to this picture, you can prove a structure theorem for your Frobenius algebras, which you can then push back down internally. So it's like studying the linear representations of a group to learn something about its structure, and you don't really care about the linear representations, it's just a means to that. So my kind of concept of observable lifts naturally to the concept of observable outside, and then also the set-like elements of the Higgs-star algebra that you started with correspond with elements of the Galfan spectrum, so they correspond with homomorphisms. So here, so this boldface A is the R mu prime, and this is an algebra homomorphism. So the notions of observables and states kind of matches up, so it's kind of a sanity check argument. So then we might ask, well, okay, it's reasonable, but is it useful? So what can we actually do with these new definitions? So based on the theorem of Dorring and Eisenberg, the Kochan-Specker theorem, I'm just going to now define an object in an arbitrary monoidal category to be contextual if this pre-sheaf has no global sections. So we know if we plug in Hilbert spaces that this has no global sections, but I can give you a category where when you plug it in, it does have global sections. So we're dealing with objects which are non-contextual. So in particular, consider categories of quantile valued relations. So this is really just a generalization of category of relations. So commutative quantile is a complete semilattice where you have this extra monoid operation. And I'm going to ask that they're zero divisor free. So this includes the two-element Boolean algebra, but also things like these intervals where you take the normal multiplication. And then rel Q has its objects, their sets, and the morphisms are Q-valued matrices. So if this is a bit obscure, you can just think of rel. Really, I proved it for rel, and then I realized that the same proof works for these things. So yeah, the theorem is that this Gafan spectrum pre-sheaf does have global sections. It has a lot of global sections. There's at least one for every element of the underlying set. You can construct one of these global sections. And the proof isn't completely trivial, and it actually does rely on the von Neumann properties, so the fact that we are considering not just the arbitrary algebras, but the ones which satisfy this von Neumann condition. And it really kind of comes down to the fact that you can find lots of projectors, which is kind of the reason why people study von Neumann C-star algebra, is you get all these projectors lying around. And the same thing kind of happens even when you consider these quite different looking algebraic objects. So under this interpretation, we kind of can say that all of these sets are non-contextual in some sense. So thinking of this result in context, a couple of years ago, Stefano Coglioso and Will Zeng wrote this paper where they gave an abstract definition of Merman non-locality, and then they showed that the category of finite sets and relations is local in this sense, right? So I've got this kind of completely different looking definition of contextual, and we would expect sets and relations to, well, if they're locals, then they should be non-contextual. So it's kind of this definition which I just came up with is at least kind of consistent with other things out there. And then there's, if you consider Speckan's toy theory, which has a representation using Frobenius algebras, and Frobenius algebras in the category of relations. And so if it has a representation with Frobenius algebras, we can use my result and just lift it, and instead think about these von Neumann semi-algebras. So you can kind of model this toy theory in this sense as well. And in that theory, it's the, if you read Speckan's original paper, it's the singleton elements of the underlying set which correspond with the local hidden variables of the system, calls it the ontic states. So then when you look at this framework, it's the ontic states really do correspond with the global sections of this pre-sheaf, which talks about the state space. So I think it gives you a nice way to sort of package these toy theories, and I think the next kind of obvious step for this stuff is to bridge the gap with this sort of sheaf theoretic framework of Samson Baranski and others, because a lot of the pieces that I have look very similar to kind of more general things that are there. So this is still, I mean, I don't really have anything that insightful or interesting to say about it now, but that's kind of what I'm now working on. And in particular, what this would let you do is, if you're interested in Frobenius algebras, and that's how you like to think about things, then using my framework, you could kind of turn all that directly into talking about empirical models and then start applying the machinery that's been developed in this approach. So it would give you a way of transporting that directly up. And yeah, that's it. Single Frobenius algebra, you want to input a collection of Frobenius algebras, and each Frobenius algebra would correspond somehow to a context. And this would give you, I think, not one way to do it, but it gives you a whole class of ways to do it, to build an empirical model, so write down a table with values. And I think it gives you a sort of a general framework in which to do that, but there is some choices to make, like what are the probabilities that come out, are the actual probabilities, or is it possibilistic, or is it something even weirder than that? I think there's kind of no limit to what you get. I think it gives you the language in which to express these things, rather than just cracking the handle and it falls out.
Okay, so what would be fantastic would be to have a way of taking sort of your favorite collection of Frobenius algebras and knowing this, you can or cannot have an ontological model corresponding to this. Mm. So you're saying you've got more a framework in which you can pose that question rather than a procedure to decide.
Yeah.
You've still got some time left for the picture.
So, a historical comment and a question. Just historically, I think the result you attributed to Döring and Isham was actually the Butterfield and Isham work from several years earlier, late 90s, actually. So it was a very pioneering insight. The question is, you have a sort of analogue of the Gelfand spectrum in the abstract level. You thought about abstract conditions under which one would have a Gelfand type duality?
I've started to think about it, but I haven't really come up with much. I think that probably not going to get a nice duality in some sense. I know that you can put a topology on these things, so. Even if you look at some of these quantile value relations, you get a compact topology on your state space, but it might not be Hausdorff. So you can get some quite kind of strange.
I think Chris Mulvey and others have looked at generalizations of Gelfand duality, so there might be something.
Okay. But just your point about being Butterfield and Isham, they, in their first paper, they had a slightly different topos. They weren't considering the commutative subalgebras. They had this other category in terms of the spectrum of the operators. And so I think that, phrased in this way.
They considered some variations, it's true, but I think the essential point was...
Yeah, I think you're right, but this version of it, I think, was the Isham.
Okay, well, let's thank our speaker again.